Yeah. This topic was given to me by Brenda, and I was first thinking, what's it about? How can you standardize the treatment of retinoblastoma? It sounded to me like an oxymoron. Who knows what is an oxymoron? Not everyone. The oxymoron, it comes from the Greek language, and it means something that is pointedly foolish. And it's pointedly foolish in the sense that the word or the sentence contains two parts that cancel each other. Elements that appear to be contradictory, but they are not only contradictory, but they are contradictory in the sense that you want to make a point. And in practice, open secret is an oxymoron, because something can't be open data and a secret at the same time, or organized mess that many of us have on our desk, or jumbo shrimp that you can buy, and an honest politician. But this is in brackets, because it's not a true oxymoron, because different people would think different ways about it, but these are unquestionably, the first part and the latter part are fighting with each other. So I thought that standardization of care in children with retinoblastoma is an oxymoron, because of course every child is different as regards genetics, both the tumor and the host response, the number, size and localization of the tumors, and as we feel, how they respond to treatment, not to mention the family dynamics and other things. So it's impossible to standardize the treatment of retinoblastoma. That's why, to me, it's an oxymoron of a title.
Could I respond to that?
In a minute. Okay. But then, you have to think a little bit further. You can't standardize the care of each individual child, because it has to be individualized, not standardized. And this is how we have the emerging field of personalized medicine. We've done personalized medicine for retinoblastoma for decades already in practice. But there is another side of this coin as well. You can standardize the procedure with which you treat the child once you have decided what treatment individually will be given. And if you standardize here, it will probably make your results better than if you don't try to standardize what you do once the decision to treat in a specific way has been made. So this is something that ideally you should standardize. And there are many levels and ways in which you can think of standardizing your treatment. It's especially important if there are multiple providers that share in the process. For example, it's easy for me to standardize because every child with retinoblastoma in Finland comes for me to treatment. In a bigger country, you may have two or three centers, and it makes sense that they collaborate with each other and try to do things in the same way, but they should then select the best way out of the three centers, hopefully based on evidence, perhaps to a common registry, just like what the international data is collected. And, of course, there can be a general practitioner or a well-baby clinic that several that share in your line of treatment how the patients come to you. And then it makes sense to try to standardize the referral procedure as well, not just the treatment procedure. And of course, if there is more ocular colonist in your center than just you, you may need to standardize in-house between two or three ocular colonists as well. And you can do, as I said, in different levels, you can have a performer. If you give intravitreal treatment, you may have a written performer that you share with the nurses and the surgery staff how it is done. Then you don't need to ask for a cryo machine, or you don't need to ask for somebody's instruments every time when you do it. And that also reduces the possibility of missing some step. And the checklist is another that will help you there. In my hospital, it's obligatory to do a checklist before you start any surgery today. So we have to check with the nurses, although we know we have to check our names. And that's more to the benefit of any visitor who happens to be in the theater than but we tell us who we are day after day after day, surgery after surgery after surgery. Even for me, who has a very short memory for names, it's helpful. Then we double, or it's already a triple check that the patient's the right one. We check what should be done to which eye. Then we check if there is any critical aspect, for example, an instrument that is needed only for this surgery. And you have to record this into the electronic system that the checklist was done. And at the moment, it's done in 97% of the surgeries in our hospital. And you can have separate checklists for different procedures. For example, a cataract has a separate checklist because it's such a common procedure. Then you can have written a national guidelines. Here I might point you to the National Retinoblastoma Strategy and the Canadian guidelines of here that are really very detailed. But any guidelines you will need to adjust to your local environment because there will be differences in the healthcare system. And there will be differences in many other aspects of the care of the patient with retinoblastoma. And then we have kind of joint registries. And another idea of all finger in these registries is not to help them to build the staging system, but it's in the future also to compare your data with the regional data so that you can see that your results are not any worse than what people generally get in your area. And Paul Finger is also propagating what he calls doctor-reported outcomes. And he would like that every center would publish their results on the website to show publicly how many eyes they enucleate, how many patients need a secondary enucleation, and so on. And he told me that if you look at the site of the New York Eye Cancer Hospital where he works, he has published some of his results as an example to others. And then you can do auditing. And the auditing is very useful if you have more than one center treating retinoblastomas because that can be informal. It doesn't need to be permanent auditing. I know that in the UK they have three centers treating retinoblastomas and they have to do self-audit and then they can send the people to the other center to see, to audit their procedure and give them advice if there is any areas that might be improved based on the experience of the center that is sending the auditor there. And I'm sure that you can devise other ways of standardizing your procedures as well. This was the long and the short of this particular topic that Brenda gave to me that made me think about this more than I had thought about this before. So thank you for that.
Thank you for
now you can comment.